Hello guys and welcome to the Grip TV broadcast of the 24 Hours of Le Mans over the Virtual Endurance Championship. Today joining me in the booth I have Stephen Bailey, a guest commentator, and you will know very well Matt Malone, the cornerstone of the Grip TV empire. Guys, 24 Hours of Le Mans, this is the biggest thing that we've taken from Grip TV, for sure. Thoughts? Thoughts so far on how this is going to go?
Oh man, well Jimmy, I'm here, yep, in the booth with you, and it's just going to be really exciting. We've been waiting a long time for this, and man, we're kind of venturing into unknown territory here, 24 hours, let's do this, I'm excited.
Definitely. And R-Factor 2, not known for its reliability over a long stint, so this is going to be an interesting test of the game, as well as our own endurance here in the box. Like I said, we have a guest commentator, Mr. Bailey. Say hello, Mr. Bailey.
Good afternoon, everyone. Good morning, afternoon, evening.
There he is. Fantastic, gentlemen. And we have a couple of pictures to show you today. First of all, you're looking at the track map of Cirque du Soleil. I'm sure you're all familiar with it. We're running a slightly different version than you see here, but this is the only map we could find. That's the one we're using. The only difference between the one you're seeing now and the one they're racing is that there's no kind of S's downhill after the Dunlop curve, which is after turn three for you guys. And that's the difference there. But 8.47 miles of pure adrenaline, pure fantastic racing, proper driver's track this one. Mr. Bailey, you're very familiar with Cirque du Soleil. I think we could even go so far as calling you a specialist. What would you say the driving to look out for in particular, in this particular track?
It's just keeping your concentration. The streaks are so long and...
Yeah, it's very... Very easy, I think, and this sort of track kind of to nod off on the straights. Obviously, you're going. Well, I say that these guys are traveling excess of 170 miles an hour for the GTs alone down there. So if you're not looking out for your braking point, going down to that first chicane, that PlayStation chicane, and you're a little bit late in your braking point, that could be the end of the race right there. And obviously, you've got to keep that between four or five drivers have to keep concentrating for 24 hours. Otherwise, race over pretty much straight away. So. That's the fun of it. This being our factor two, we are using the kind of real weather plugin, which is taking weather forecasts from around the world. In this case, obviously from Le Mans Village in Maine, in France, as it says here. I probably said that completely incorrectly. And let's have a look at that now. Weather forecasts looking pretty good for the first couple of days. Going to have low temperatures around 19, 20 Celsius. Pretty nice for the tyres. Rain. Kind of looking a possibility in the first part of the race, first half of the race, but then we get to tomorrow morning and 90% probability of rain, 90%, so almost certain to see rain tomorrow. It's really going to open up the race at that point, really going to change the pace, considering these guys have been driving for 12 hours at that point, and then bam, rain. That's going to be a shock to the system, no doubt. So guys, just looking now at the P1 table from series standings after the last race. Leading the field currently is Satellite Racing, and I think we should go over this now before we kind of go into the race. There's only one entry for this particular this race for Le Mans, only one P1 entry. That is a Target Racing team. So given that they get to the end of the race all right, they'll go to the top of the league. That's pretty much all we can say about the P1 field. Unfortunately, a lot of people not being able to find the drivers, not being able to find the time. Obviously, 24 hours is a long commitment for anyone who isn't actually a professional racing driver. So unsurprising to see some people drop out, but it's disappointing when you have one car in the field. But it does mean, however, we're going to be able to focus a lot on the GT class, currently headed by Odin Racing. They won last time out at Long Beach. Good race from them. Hopefully they'll be aiming to replicate that result. But obviously, differences. 2.45 hours of Long Beach versus 24 hours of Le Mans. It's a sprint race in comparison, you know. You're doing it's a five lap race on Gran Turismo in comparison. It really is a massive difference.
Yeah, no doubt. I mean, this is you know, we got Odin Racing here with Rosenli and Ciampa, and you know, these guys really got to be able to manage their driver swaps here, get their schedules just right in order to make this work here. But yeah, 24 hours, a heck of a lot different than what we've seen in the past. So this is a whole new experience for most of these guys, and it'll be exciting to see how they manage it.
What I'm most interested is that you've just gone through their names there, Rosenli and Ciampa. That's only two drivers, and as you know, this is 24 hours a month, so that's 12 hours each if you split that in half. The most I've driven, I think, has been about 3 hours, maybe 3.5 hours in a stint, and I was done. That was in a row, though. Obviously, I had to go and sleep after that. Was it you, Mr. Bailey, who did the 8-hour race on your own? Was that you?
Yeah, a couple of seasons ago at Daytona, that was...
Yeah, that's a...
Just about my least favourite track in the world, and I had to do bloody 8 hours right now.
Completely different kettle of fish, that one. I'm glad I wasn't in that position. 8 hours, Jesus. I can't imagine sitting. I don't think my back would last that long, but then again, that's the...
It didn't.
The perks of being an old man. So at the moment, the server is just switching over to qualifying. We'll be on that when that starts. At the moment, there is no action on track at the moment. So I think we should talk a little bit about the kind of the wildcard entry into this race. The URD Corvette, you guys may know that mod. It's the EGT mod by United Racing Development. And it's been confirmed already as the Season 7 car. So they're going to be racing this mod next season. And as a kind of like extended test, Jimmy Allison and his team of Bianchi Motorsports, who aren't going to be racing in this race in their team, they're going to be racing as a kind of a non-competitive team, just a bit like the Delta Wing, I guess. It'll be a good comparison that Mr. Bailey made earlier. To kind of see how it fares over a long distance. Now, there were initial concerns about wear, especially for tyres. The URD Corvette has a very, or that mod in particular, has very, you have to, temperamental tyres, you have to look after them. There was a race I did yesterday in the wet at Loch Drummond, not quite Le Mans, a little bit less exotic up in sunny Scotland, but you know, the tyres fell off the cliff so quickly in the wet. If you understeered, they heated up, and definitely just became a challenge, and that's something I think that will be really good when it's implemented into this level of endurance racing.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, I've taken a look at these Corvettes here. They're beautiful to look at, and man, they are quick on these really long straightaways. These guys are flying, and yeah, like you said, this is going to be a great test for these guys on out here for the new mod, the new car. So yeah, I'm excited to see those Corvettes on out here. You know, they're looking good out there in the nice sunshine. Let's see how they handle some of the weather and some of the tire wear. But yeah, it should be good.
Well, yeah, definitely. As we're just getting the broadcasting tool working, as always. As you know, with our Vector 2, broadcasting is an interesting affair, and we've been doing our best going for the season as it is. Currently having a couple of issues. We'll be back to that very quickly, though. Qualifying is yet to start, so you're not missing out on anything yet, guys. Don't worry. At the moment, just trying to get this unlocked.
Yep, and want to thank everybody for joining. If you guys want to ask us any questions during the stream, head on over to Grip TV Live Twitter and send your questions to @GripTVLive, and we'll make sure to be reading those during the race. We want to interact with you guys. If you missed any of the past broadcasts, head on over to the Grip TV Live YouTube account, where you can see some video on demand, and also check out the brand new Facebook page, Grip TV Live Facebook. So it's a great way for everybody to get interactive and you know, become part of the community. We all love racing. We all like watching racing, and we're trying to give you the best experience possible here. So yeah, get interactive. Head on over to Grip TV Live Twitter and start asking questions.
Definitely. I guess on the subject of thanks, I think we should thank our German behind-the-scenes wizard, Mr. Timo Wessendahl. You know him as Super Diramiro, who has provided all the images, put them all together for us, put together a massive chunk of this broadcast for us, and he won't be commentating, I don't think, at any point. He's just going to be behind the scenes, so big thank you to him before we start. A lot of this wouldn't happen without you, so thank you very much for your efforts.
Huge thank you. I just want to thank Timo, yeah, personally. He's up with all the graphics that you're looking at, and yeah, big props to Timo. He's the behind the scenes worker there, working hard, so yeah, props to him.
So we get, as we're just now still waiting for the session to go, qualifying will be split into it was going to be split into two different classes, but we only have the one prototype car out there now, so it's a full 25 minutes of qualifying. Everyone's allowed on the track at once. So for Rodrigo Borba and maybe the URD Corvette, which is slightly faster, than the DT cars. We'll have a bit of a challenge on the hands to kind of navigate traffic, but otherwise it should be okay. Obviously there is that difference between the faster and the slower guys. Not everyone's at the same sort of race pace, which is not a bad thing at all. But obviously it does mean that we will see some, maybe some interesting overtaking manoeuvres try on qualifying laps, just trying to get past people to, you know, really maximise that time.
Yeah, and you have to wonder, you know, with a track like this with such long straightaways here, maybe these guys are going to be timing out their qualifying lap just so they catch a little bit of that draft. You can see that here coming.
Definitely, I mean, that will really be very helpful, especially for the GTs. You can hear now I've got the session up, so let's go to that. There's our fancy new over there now watching Rodrigo Borba practicing our lone prototype entry in the Target Racing car. These guys are probably going to end up being top of the championship if he doesn't do that in his in the race and piss off at Indianapolis. No pressure at all. I think for these guys, I'm not sure what the rules are concerning points, but I think it's if you complete 75% of the race and you crash, you're still eligible for points. I mean, that's something we'll have to probably confirm, but I think that is the rule. So he could pretty much just park it after 18 hours. I'm done now. And go from there.
Yeah, and I think one of the most important things here for the P1 car, since there's only one out there, is just kind of beware of the traffic and just have to be real patient with getting through the GT cars. And, you know, I think just being out here, enjoying the event is going to be a big part of it. But, you know, with only the one out there, got to be careful and, you know, we'll see how that goes.
Yeah, I mean, you see him now all lining up at pit exit. We're watching Jimmy Allison Shaw trying to get up for the rest of the cars, and Rodrigo Borba probably doing the best thing he can do and just sticking his car in the pit lane so he can get out first, as he does. So that's something he will definitely want to have done. And now it's the GT scrum to who can get round first. I'm sure that Odin Racing car will be trying its best to get in front of the Corvette, seeing as they tend to be fairly quick round here and a fairly quick GT entry so far. You'll see in the straight line, though, the Corvette will just walk away from the rest of the cars. That GTE car a little bit faster than straight line. Top speed for the Corvette, I've seen about 184 so far, I think.
Yeah, I practice myself. It's yes. We're looking at a 5 to 10 mile an hour difference potentially between the GTE car and the GT3s.
Yeah, but that's very much top speed. It's not so much acceleration. Yeah. You know, sorry, this is Rafael Sosa, sorry, on the track, not Rodrigo Borba, apologies for that. But yeah, it's not top speed. The GT3 cars, which are the kind of the rest of the field, are pretty quick off the corners, and they'll pretty much equal the GTE cars, which is the Corvette, up until about 150 mile an hour. Then that's when the legs in the Corvette will start to kick in, and you'll see the speed differences take place.
Yeah, I mean, just look at that Corvette, man. That thing is something else. Look at it. Just what a beautiful car, and man, I really hope it you know, works out good here. You know, experimental kind of thing. Going here, first kind of big test for it, but man, it's great seeing that thing out there.
I think now probably be a good time to talk about the competition that the Virtual Endurance Championship was running, where if you liked and shared a picture, you were up for a chance of winning a URD license, which means the whole set of cars, you will have them bought for you for free by the Virtual Endurance Championship. In the end, we had to sort it by who liked it, unfortunately, instead of who liked and shared it because of some issues we had with Facebook. But we picked a winner randomly out of a hat, and I'm sure we'll make someone very happy today. The winner was Rodrigo Borba from the Target Racing team. So he has won a URD license. So congratulations, Rodrigo. I'm sure that'll be given to you after the race by Jimmy Allison. And again, congrats from us at Grits TV. I'm jealous you don't have to buy that. No, I did. But you guys pretty much now have, or you have free entry now pretty much into Season 7. So congratulations, Rodrigo, on winning the VEC competition there for the URD license. So congratulations there.
Very nice.
But now we'll go back to qualifying, I guess. Nothing's happening so far. Everyone's on their outlap. It's a long outlap here, pretty much nearly 4 minutes or so if you're kind of cruising around, maybe a bit longer. I think 4 minutes is actually a decent lap time for some of these guys in the field. So we'll keep an eye on Sposa, because he'll be the guy who gets around to his flying lap first. He's coming up to the Porsche curves. Big bump going into the Porsche curves, Mr. Bailey. Would you see that upsetting some of the cars today, do you think?
Could do some of them. Certainly, it was a big challenge in the Corvette when I was testing it as well. Chuck the inside wheels up in the air a little bit, turning. It's couple of times ended up in the wall out there. It wasn't much fun.
Yeah, you got to make sure that that's not happening for real, especially in this race. Because going to the wall, you're carrying a lot of speed into there, you know, 120 or mile an hour into that corner. And then if you go into the wall at that speed, then it's pretty much going to be race over. Let's see if we can join Mr. Borba in the cockpit view. We can now. On board with the AMR car. Coming up to the Dunlop chicane. And into sixth gear. Just going to spy on the braking point. Keeping it to the right as much as you can to get, kind of make the line as straight as possible through the chicane. Now down the hill now, coming up to the Forest S's. Again, the part where momentum is key and the downforce cars really really sing through here. Really cranking up the lock both left and right. The car doing exactly what it wants it to. And now for Tetra Rouge. This is very important, this corner for speed onto the straight. Any mistakes going into that corner pretty much mean you're going to have a bad run all the way down the straight. And here we go. Now these cars get up to about 190 or so miles an hour down here, maybe a bit more if the downforce is low. I'm not sure we have our speed trap on.
Maybe 210 here with the P1s.
Oh wow, so okay. So these guys really dialing in now for these guys for this track. Obviously now breaking ever so late into play station, getting the really straight lining chicane as much as you can. Fantastic effort there. Now the kind of the mini relax, as you call it, just kind of chilling on the straight, pulling it there. You'll see them pull the car over to the right very gently to prepare for the Michelin chicane, which is the left, right, left. Coming out to the 100 meter board, braking, trying to get the car onto that inside curb as much as you can. Running a little bit wide off the apex mid corner, but was okay for the rest of it.
Yeah, 210 miles an hour going into that chicane, unbelievable.
Wow, that is pretty insane. We'll make sure to get our speed trap on so you guys can see that when they're coming around next time around. Now coming down to the Mulsanne corner, very interesting. You have to kind of turn a little bit, then brake. You have to make sure you don't do the both at the same time. Runs a little bit wide, not too bad. Got the back end was a little bit loose coming off there, but seemed to be all right. Now another rest. There's a lot of these on the track, as you can call them. They're not really rests though, considering you're going 200 plus mile an hour between trees, effectively. And coming up now to the Indianapolis complex. Now this is a very fast right hander followed by quite a quick left hander if you can get it right. But this is where a lot of the people make mistakes around here, taking that first right hander a bit too quick, and then ending up just going off into the runoff. We saw Borba do it in practice, but suppose he has no problem through there. Now up to Arnage, very tight corner, first gear for a lot of the cars. Really hitting his marks.
Pretty narrow track here. You know, you want to use every inch of the track as possible, but man, it's pretty narrow here. So you really got to rely on your good turn in there and good exit.
Definitely. I mean, you see here going for the Porsche curve again, getting everything right as properly. He hits the bump a little bit. The back looked like it slid a little bit, but not too much. Kept it in check. These cars really quick for this part of the course. All about threading the needle. And now up to the last course, the Fort Chicane. Restrictions on this, similar to real life. Doesn't matter really matter how much you cut, as long as you get through it without setting off the warning from R Factor. There he goes. First chicane was pretty nice. Second chicane, looking good. Coming up to the line now. What kind of times is it going to be? 3:11.1, which is very quick. A very quick lap from Schroeder. It's a bit quicker than you see in real life. But
that's the quickest time I've seen all week. That's really quick.
Yeah. And I'm pretty sure now, as the ugly GTR, as we've named it, gets in the way of Borba a little bit. As he spins out, trying to get out of the way, and there's contact. But I don't think, Swoza is in any trouble of having his pole position challenged at all. So he should be okay there, I think.
I think he's okay.
So we'll join Per Rosny now in the Elgin Racing Gallardo. He's coming up now into the last sector of the course. Just to give you an idea of how much quicker the prototypes are, Per Rosny is now on 3 minutes 11 on his lap now. He's yet to hit the Porsche curve. So that's the difference between the prototypes and the GTs around here. And especially this corner, you'll see the front bump a little bit going into the corner. It almost looks like as the rear gets unsettled through that bump for a lot of the cars through there. Maybe something can set up, maybe something's different. We can only hypothesize, we're in the box. We don't know the ins and outs of the team. But looks like he got that right hander a little bit too shallow, actually going for that last part, touching the grass on the exit of the left hander. I always remember this part from the the racing game grid. You can cut this as much as you want, pretty much take it 160 mile an hour, very realistic. Can't be doing that here, as attacks the curbs, use all the runoff on the exit, and does a 3.57.9, fairly respectable time. We've seen quicker, as Celfo Sardina behind him takes the GT position, takes the GT pole. What we'll probably do is we'll just have the GTs up, because we know who's going to be pole for the for the prototypes.
We could be looking at something in the 3.53s for pole for GT, mm-hmm. potentially.
Does depend on getting that lap hooked up, though. There's a lot of places you can mess up, especially through those Porsche curves, through this first section as well. Every corner around here is worth a lot of time, so it's very important to get that a good pace.
It was 25 minutes around here. Isn't a very long session at all. 4 minutes around for an 8-lap.
Definitely not.
Yeah, every single lap here, you really want to get a nice clean lap in, try to get a good time. Every single one is so important here, with almost pushing 4 minute lap times here. Wow.
Just watching now the URD Corvette again, busting down the straight. So quick, these cars in a straight line compared to the other cars. I won't be surprised if he ends up getting onto the back of the Ferrari in front of him. I think that's one of the CMHQ cars. The 297.8 kilometers an hour down there for the Corvette. Fire our little speed trap app there.
Let me get my conversions out, aren't you?
Yeah, we don't believe in kilometres an hour here in the UK. Miles per hour or go home.
Pizzo's gone to pole in GT3 with a 55.0.
Very impressive time there. We'll see if we can get the times up for you guys. You can get a better idea. There you go, there the time. So currently 1.1 seconds over Sardina is Daniel Pizzo. See if we can get a camera on him. Here he is in the Ferrari, the 458, so the GT Italia team. GT Italia have had an interesting season so far. They were very quick at Sebring, and then encountered issues. They were kind of nowhere really in Long Beach. I think there were some issues there for them at some point, because I didn't really see them at all throughout the entire race. They were somewhere towards the back, and now showing their true, one lap pace. Whether that translates to the race, we'll have to wait and see, but that's part of racing, isn't it? You can be as quick as you can over a single lap, but if you can't get to the end of the race, there's no point.
Absolutely.
Yep. Pizzo, his team, they're sitting at sixth place right now in the GT series.
So sixth place, yeah. So looking maybe to take 4 points away from this 24-hour encounter that is Le Mans, but we'll have to wait and see. Did you get the conversion of that miles per hour there, Mr. Bailey?
It's 185 miles an hour for the Corvette.
Very quick. Very quick indeed. I'm not quite sure how that compares to real-life GTE cars. I'm sure you'll be able to tell me in a flash if you... But,
well, it's not that dissimilar, I think. It's pretty good. I'd have to go and look at the data myself again. My memory isn't the greatest in the world.
I know you love the data. No, I know. Now looking at the Northern Light car, they're currently being driven by Halvorsen. Currently sitting in fourth position in the GTs. Northern Light, again, checkered season so far. I think that one of their cars could have won both of the races we've had previous. Sebring then encountered issues as he actually pulls over now. I think he's actually abandoning the lap for whatever reason. Maybe trying a different qualifier. I'm not entirely sure what they're doing there, but... Maybe that wasn't too great for him. He's in the number one car, but we saw him at Long Beach, Malone. I'm sure you remember this, leading the GT, and then they blew up. They blew up, yeah, double downshift.
Right. Yep, that's right. They've always been in contention there, running up front. Just have some issues there that kind of threw it all away. But sitting right now, third place in the standings, this is a really big opportunity for them to really come out strong here and really make it a team effort. And try to get up front and stay out front is what it's all about.
Mm-hmm.
I just know we've had Jimmy Allison go to the top of the... he's beaten all the GT3s with his Corvette on a 54.9.
54.9, I mean, the fastest time we saw from you... Did you manage to get into the 52s in the end, Bailey, with your...
Not quite, it was a 53.1.
Yeah,
50... I never had a soft tyre, low fuel running it, but it was...
So 52s... are possible around here for the Corvette. Maybe in 51 if you really pushed it. We're talking high 51, of course. But you see now the difference between the two cars. I mean, normally Jimmy isn't the fastest qualifier we see out here. Obviously, being the nicest we can be. But you see, you know, how competitive that car is compared. I think, you know, obviously quicker, different class, different type of vehicle here.
Yeah, now we got Pizzo coming in with a 354, which does beat the Corvette there.
And there you go then, really, you know, pulling out the stops there is Pizzo. As he now extended his lead to Sardina to 1.6 seconds. So going 5/10 quicker on this lap than he did on his previous fastest lap.
Now with such a short qualifying session here, and with different teammates here on each team, you know, do you just pick your pick fastest guy to do the qualifying, or is there going to be any driver swaps during qualifying?
Well, pretty much what you'll see is there'll be one driver elected to do the qualifying. That decision will be made a long time ago before the race. Usually it is anyway, if you're in an organized team. And you just pick the fastest driver to go out and do a lap, usually. So, for example, let's say me, myself, and Mr. Bailey, you, Mr. Malone, and Mr. Bailey are in a team. We send out Mr. Bailey with his alien skills to do a qualifying lap and then reel him back in. Some leagues ask that the qualifying driver do the first stint. I'm not sure if that's the case here. But yeah, they'll go out and do the qualifying lap, and then obviously you put in a different drive maybe to start the race. But qualifying isn't too important in endurance races, to be honest. I mean, unless you're really at the back where, you know, you could get into trouble and maybe get in some sort of contact, it doesn't really affect you that much. It's such a long race, you drive so many miles around here that it doesn't really, you know, matter if you're, you know, a couple of yards behind on the start.
I mean, for a 24-hour race as well, it's I don't see it being particularly important for this race. I mean, for a race like Long Beach, it would have been more important if it being 2 hours 45. But here, no.
I mean, it's more temporary bragging rights, I think.
Yeah, bragging rights, absolutely. You all like bragging rights.
I've just watched one of the Ferraris, one of the sim racing cars, going to the war in Indianapolis. I'm not quite sure who that was. I'll see if I can get a replay on that. Our replay function is a bit funky, so. If it doesn't work, then please bear with us. And it's not going to work, unfortunately, so maybe we won't see that replay again. Yes, we will. Here we go. We'll swim man view. Goes into Indianapolis. Just gets it loose on the... Hits that. Looks like it was an invisible wall on the inside there, actually. He got right into the inside. Maybe it was an anti-cut of some sort. I'm not quite sure why you would need one there, but unfortunately, that was the end of that run for him, losing the front end.
It looked like the front end dug into the curve. End, yeah.
Running a very low front end there, it seems. But otherwise,
well, better now, I guess, than during the race.
Now you know.
So we are currently watching the difficult name team that we've assigned to Mr. Bailey to say going round at the moment.
Oh, thank you.
Yet to set a time in the sim racing PL Gallardo. Just coming round now, I think. No, this isn't a flying lap. I think this is an outlap. Yeah, it is an outlap because almost 5 minutes. Leaving it very late to go and set a time, indeed, but I'm sure he'll get round fine. For his sake, I hope he does, because he won't have much time to go round again after that.
He's probably got time for three more laps if he can do 4 minutes and under.
As the police come for Bailey in the background.
Yeah, with about just over 8 minutes left here in qualifying. If you haven't put a time down yet, you better work on just get a nice clean lap on out there. Just post something.
Yeah, I mean, we just watched Pietro there just lock up massively going up into the Dunlop chicane, pretty much all the way up the hill, and the tyres aren't going like that at all. They have a massive flat spot on those tyres now, and that's not really the start you want for your flying lap.
Not at all. The way the tyres work in RFX 2 as well, it will really punish him.
Just had a quick message from our technical advisor, Mr. Vesendal, asking to make you guys a little bit louder, so we will do that. I'm sure you'll have a chance
really
to be a little bit louder.
Me. I don't know.
They're already loud, that's all I can say. We'll try that, and then if they're deaf than me, then I'm blaming you guys. Still watching this guy go down the straight now. 280. 81.2 kilometers an hour. So not actually too much slower than the Corvette that time around. I think there's 9 kilometers in it, so that's about 5 miles an hour or so. Very quickly, mass. That's probably incorrect. But no, not 5 miles an hour is a lot, I guess, in the grand scheme of things. But from what we've seen so far, it's a smaller gap we've seen between the cars so far. So not entirely too bad. Here's Pablo Flores for the FVR team. Not a team I've actually seen take part so far. So maybe a new entry for Le Mans. Not seen them in practice either. Maybe doing their own offline practice. Not advisable, especially with the real road building up. But let's see, that's another Gallardo. Again, sporting the orange livery. A lot of people are liking the orange cars so far around here. I think there's some sort of thing I'm missing out on. Obviously, we have the Odin Racing car, which is fire pretty much, as the Flores misses his braking zone going into PlayStation. Didn't quite hit his mark there, but back on the road with no incident, luckily. I think I hear a Corvette somewhere in the background. Yes, there it is. Unmistakable sound of the Corvette coming flying up behind him. Not quite sure. I think that might be. Is that Jimmy in the Corvette there?
It is.
And we'll go on board with Jimmy and we'll show you just the difference in speed between the two. So here we are on board. You see the cockpit. We've got that nice kind of rear view camera to the right of us. Jimmy very cautious going into the second chicane, that Michelin chicane there. I think these cars are allowed to run a click of traction control.
Here now, yeah, he's looking to pick up a little bit of draft here, so that'll increase his speed a bit.
Yeah, I mean,
Corvette needs help.
Yeah, Corvette needs know-how. I mean, maybe a little bit too far away to get anything effective. He's a bit closer now towards the end of the straight, but now we come down into that hard braking zone on the Mulsanne corner. Very easy to go wide in this car, I find. Jimmy shifting down to first gear. Second gear is used the corner. Second gear is used the corner you want to take through there to carry momentum. Looks like he's still warming his tyres, though. He's on an outlap currently, so no biggie. Sun blaring from behind us right now. You can see in the mirror, blinded by the sunlight. And the car in front also weaving around. So possibly both on outlaps, but you still see the difference in momentum between the two as Jimmy, that speck on the horizon getting bigger and bigger as Jimmy pulls up behind him. I think that's going to be a spin. I just saw that.
Whoa!
Oh no, he keeps it under wraps. Well saved. Just watching. I think Jimmy giving them a bit of a gap now. Sorry, I was just amending some sound settings again. This is what the qualifying is for. yeah, but Jimmy giving a little bit of gap between him and the car in front. He doesn't encounter him on the fast lap. But he needs to get a move on though. He wants to do another lap after this. I think this is going to be his last qualifying attempt. He won't get across the line again after this, so I'm not quite sure. He doesn't really need to go around again. But Pizzo's still actually leading the all the GTs altogether in the Ferrari with a 354.5. He is still out on track at the moment, and he is going fast than his previous time. He's 3 tenths up at Sector 1. Sector 2 ends around here, so we'll see if he's still up at the next split. He is up, he's lost a little bit of time, he's lost five hundredths of a second, but now this is where all the time will come to him if he gets it right, and he'll lose it if he gets it wrong. The Porsche curve's all about momentum through here. Straight lining this little mini straight as much as you can, very difficult because it kind of waves back and forth. Pulling all the way over to the left now, spotting the turning point, and there it is. Looking very smooth through there at the moment. Touching that outside curb a tiny bit and the inside curb, then heavy braking. Getting the car down to about third gear for here, depending on what kind of gear set you're running. And trying to take as much speed through this little kind of left as you can. It's very difficult through there for sure. Now coming up to the fourth chicane, or the anti-chicane, where you just basically cut as much as you can. How much does he take out of it? Almost legal for a second part of it, almost. And he comes across the line, does go faster. 54.0, very competitive time. That was 5 tenths faster. He gained 2.5 tenths through that last sector there, just showing how much time can be gained through there if you get it right, and he did.
Yeah, he's definitely looking good out there, hitting all his spots, just real nice and smooth. Wow, he's got things together. He must have been practicing quite a bit here leading up to this race, that's for sure.
Indeed, a lot of the cars coming in now. Last lap for anyone on track at the moment, it seems, so we'll Jimmy Allison's in. We'll come on with Thiago Carvalho. He's the next threat, I guess, for Pirlo, but he's 1.6 seconds behind. Really coming flying up to the back of the sim racing PL Gallardo of a difficult name team.
Carvalho's last lap was 2 seconds faster than he'd managed previously. He's on a 55.6 now.
He is 4 tenths down at the moment, though. I'm sure that encountering the Gallardo in the middle of Mulsanne corner didn't do too much for him.
Yeah, it looks like he might have got slowed down just a little bit. But we'll see how he can manage the rest of this lap.
So, yeah, it's going to be a big effort now. He needs to go 2 seconds quicker from here to challenge the pole sitter. I'm not sure it's going to happen. I think it is. And there it is. The spin through Indianapolis getting in the way of the other car as well, unfortunately. So that's going to be 2 laps ruined. And I'm sure he's kicking himself there. But not too big of an issue. Obviously, they are that second place in GT class is pretty much confirmed for them. It's up to now Salvo Sardina if he can do any better. But he is 3 tenths up currently in Sector 2. So, possible. He needs a couple more, though. He needs to get these Porsche curves absolutely right if he's going to take away that second position in the GTs. Here we go. Got yellow flag in the last sector. There's why. Car on the wall. We didn't see who that was. I think it was... I didn't see that. Well, I think it might have been the target car at a glimpse.
Yes, it was.
There you go. The Comtech glimpse working for a change. As he comes down to the Ford chicane. What can he do through here? How aggressive is he going to be? A little bit too fast, I think he went into the first part of that, but pretty quick for the second half of it. What's it going to be? He does go quicker, but it's not enough. And actually loses out now, because Paznicki came through and actually tipped him while we weren't watching, so he actually loses the position there, which is a real shame for him, I imagine.
Yeah, but look at these times. I mean, 355.6, 355.8, 355.8. I mean, these are tight times here. So, man, these guys are on the same level here. Very impressive. I've been keeping my eye on Allison here, and he's just had some issues here. Allison in that Corvette right now sitting third overall. Yeah.
Just currently watching Pablo Flores on a pretty decent lap compared to his best. 1.8 seconds up on what it was, so this all might be a little bit. Not going to be enough for a competitive spot, I don't think. Probably in the top six. Let's have a look. Go seventh, almost right. Go seventh in the FBR team. Not a bad showing from them at all. TT Motorsport still out there. It's an outlap, so it won't count, so they need to come in. And Des Morissette on a flying lap at the moment. The second lap on his best time, but not going to be near the hot end. He might be able to come out of the last position for the GTs. Let's have a look. Yep, demotes TT Motorsport to last in the GT class, and that I think is going to be it, unless these guys still know that. No, that is it. Qualifying is over, and these are the results as they stand. Rodrigo Borba taking the overall pole over 3:11. Very quick time from him. No competition from the P1s. He was the only car in there, so that'll be him done. In the GTs, Daniel Pizzo in that sim, the GT Italia car, comes home in first with a 3:54.0. Not a time to be scoffed at all. Very quick, almost 2 seconds quicker than the next guy down the road. So really good showing from those guys. There will be a warm-up session coming. See if the drivers are going to get into the mindset, get the right drivers in the server, get everything going, and then we'll be going green for the 24 hours of Le Mans. So mega excited for that. Just to go over again, because I've just been asked this in TeamSpeak, Rodrigo Borba won the URD license. He was our winner for the competition for the VEC share and like poster, and he did that, and he was the one who picked out of a hat, and it was his name that came out of it. So I'm sure if his team can win the race and get that license, it'll be a good day for him. Just watching. I think at the moment what's happening now is that Sim Racing PL team, difficult name team, are just getting a little bit of last minute practice in. They don't really need to, they aren't going to beat their time or anything. Actually, sorry, they are on the lap. Apologies, I didn't think they were. I think they got over the line just in time, so apologies for that. And they're 1.7 seconds quicker than their best. So we do still have a car on track. This is why you shouldn't listen to me all the time, because I apparently overlook things. At the moment, I can't really see them on the leaderboard. They are running last, I think.
Yes,
17th overall, yep.
And they're running last.
If he can improve, he needs to shave about three and a half seconds off his time to make up a spot here off Kevin Wood.
Yeah, I just saw how he really tiptoed through Indianapolis and trying to get it right. Lost a lot of time in doing so, down to 0.8 up on his best time. His best is a 4.07.5, so he needs to be going a lot quicker than that. Kevin Wood setting a time almost 10 seconds off pole position, so that's a 4.04. Just waiting now. Yeah, he needs to go a lot quicker through here. Does Peter locks up a little bit going into the Porsche curve. That's not going to put him in good stead for the rest of it. It's all about rhythm this part. You can see the difference between the drivers a bit more practice and those who are maybe lacking some. Of just the speed difference they take through the Porsche curve. It's all about momentum. I'm sure you can attest to that, Bailey, being the quickest GTE lap so far around here. Although you're not competing, just doing it for bragging rights, are you? Just showing off now.
I couldn't resist driving the car, but no, it's all momentum through there. If you lose your rhythm through this, you're basically in the wall.
Comes across the line, and yep, he goes last. So that's qualifying done now. I think. Let me just check my
that
big wall of text.
Yeah.
It is. He's going around again though, but he's done. So needs to hit that escape key. He locks up anyway, big time. He's done that a lot, has Peter. So maybe he's having issues with that kind of turn one. But you know, we'll have to see what goes from this. Now we're in warm up. The UI needs to very quickly reset itself. So we'll quickly just pop back to. Oh no, there you go. It's done it before I've had the chance. So it's 5 minutes of warm up now. Guys have left chance to very quickly go out, you know, make sure the race setup is on the car. You don't want to have the qualifying set up on around here, definitely, especially for this long a race. You'll see the engine blowing up before you know it. And that's something that's interesting around here, I guess, guys. The prospect of engine wear, considering you're on the full throttle for quite a lot of a lap around here. How important is it to keep that engine under wraps?
Massively important. It shouldn't be too bad as long as you're not over revving the car. If you're over revving the car and downshifting too quickly, that's what's going to do the real damage to these cars.
I mean, you do see a lot of people doing that sometimes, you know, coming down to, you know, through the gears especially. I mean, I know someone who was nicknamed Gianni who has big issues coming down through the gears, especially in these, you know, the temperamental cars, and very often had to pretty much teach himself to stop going down the gears so quickly in order not to blow up his car. And that's something that we saw in the last race. It was an accidental double downshift, though. It wasn't, you know, intentional, but these cars will let go on you if you aren't careful.
Let's show how sensitive the engines are.
Yeah,
let me ask you this, though, as far as the early going stages here of this long race, these guys are kind of going to be grouped up together here, and with these long straightaways, getting that real dirty air, is that going to have an effect on engine temp, you think?
Possibly, but not enough for it to be, you know, a big issue. I mean, unless you are, you know, doing the NASCAR style, staying behind someone, I mean, for the entire lap, for the entire race, you see issues. I mean, the only kind of upside, I guess, to having the draft would be, you know, the slight increase in speed down the straight. You won't get as bad as you get, because in, you know, the NASCAR race, I guess that's what you're kind of referencing a little bit, but there won't be too much of that, I don't think, going on. It will be in the DTs if anywhere, because you have to bear in mind that, you know, Borba's team, Target, are going to be on their own in this race, effectively, to get to the end, which I guess it'll be a nice little project for them to do, but it's a shame there's no competition for them. It really is. The P1 battle is always very interesting to watch. But yeah, we'll just have to see how the race goes on, how wear comes into it. I'm looking forward to it, though, definitely.
Yeah, for sure. 24-hour race. Oh, man, what do we got? What are we looking for pit windows here for fuel and tires?
Oh, that's an interesting question.
I honestly don't know.
Yeah, I'm not quite sure. And as you say, that warm-up, we have our first rain shower. Very interesting. Now, we were told there would be about a 20 to 30% chance of rain at the start of this race, and that's going to throw some strategies up in the air. And rain driving is completely different to dry driving. There's a lot more, you know, you have to be a lot more progressive on the throttle, a lot kinder with the steering. And you can't do what you do in qualifying and, you know, in the prototypes where you just yank the steering wheel left to right to get through corners. You have to be very nice and careful, and that brief shower has passed, apparently. So it's come and gone. A little bit of a damp track now, so that'll be very interesting. I'm sure Jimmy is rubbing his hands in delight at the prospect of
yeah Yeah, starting this race here with a 30% chance. Well, we saw it there, but looks like according to the forecast here, it drops down to about a 20%. So just a little passing shower, just a little passing shower, and hopefully the track dries up here pretty quick.
But something I should mention, obviously with the race coming up very shortly, only a minute and 40 seconds till we go into the race session, the green flag will be dropped. They won't do a full formation lap. They're going to go round to Tetra Rouge, which is the corner coming onto the long straight, the Mulsanne straight, and that is where they will go green. So a little bit of pacing, just make sure the car's in the right place, and then they'll go green down there. So that's going to be interesting. And people with the speed differences, the Corvette's going to just go past everyone at the straight, so we might just watch him at the start. I think the Corvette's going to be an interesting car to watch, you know.
Definitely is. It's so with the way it seems to struggle more getting off the corners around the later parts of the lap, interesting to see how that affects the racing with the GT3s.
Definitely is. Now the race session has officially begun, and we are watching now the grid, just counting down now to that green flag to run round two, the green flag, and all the cars getting ready on the grid. Let's make sure we've got that prototype out there. We'll keep the GT timing up for now because they're going to be guys we're going to be watching, because they are the massive field. And here we go for the pace lap, and we are watching Jimmy Allison in his Corvette as they pull away nice and slowly. See the green flag's being waved now. See Borbert leading the field. Pretty much he's just going to just drive away at the start. There's going to be no threat for him at all. Actually, I think it'll probably be a bit more interesting to watch the lead GT3 car and how he deals with the Corvette of Jimmy Allison. Just rolling around now, making sure they got the car all set up the right way. Different tyre strategies than some people there. Some people in the white label tyres, which I believe are the medium tyre. Correct me if I'm wrong, Mr.
That's
Bailey.
Correct.
Finally got that right. And some on the yellow soft tyre. No, none of the red hards at the moment, which is interesting considering this is endurance race. I guess that the medium tyre is enough. And some
we are seeing is some combinations in tyres. There's the NLR number one Ferrari running on mediums on the front and softs on the rear.
Yeah, we've seen that a lot as the season's gone on. You see Rodrigo Borba just weaving a little bit at the top, is that Borba in the car? I keep calling him Borba. It's Rafael Sosa again. He's in the car just weaving around, just making a little bit of a gap so he hasn't got to deal with the GTs right at the start. And I'm very much looking forward to seeing this Corvette just drive past the Ferrari. He's not part of that race, so I'm not quite sure what kind of attitude he's going to take. Maybe he'll just let them get on with it, because he's effectively just a one big roadblock between them and the next class. But here we go, green flag, Tetra Rouge for the 24 hours of Le Mans VEC style. Rodrigo Borba pulls away, and here comes GT Field coming flying down now the Mulsanne straight for the first time of many, no doubt. Dry track as we come round for the first time, coming up now to the PlayStation chicane. Corvette sitting in the sixth stream of the Ferrari, and here it goes straight away. Pulls past that massive straight line speed advantage into second place overall.
Up to 183 miles an hour. That just zooms right past up into second place right off the bat here.
That's right, and I'll be interested to see actually. See the difference in the cornering speed then. There's
a Nissan on fire in the chicane already.
Nissan on fire, who was that, sorry?
205 car is done.
Oh no.
Who was that,
on
sorry?
Fire, flames coming out the back, that's Munkholm.
I haven't put that on my list, but we can pretty much assume that he double downshifted or downshifted too much, and end of his race before it began.
Racing Tech, whoa, unfortunate here. You don't want to see that.
Well, that's not ideal for them at all. So they're out of the race. There is no rejoining from there. But now back to the head of the GT field. Sorry, go ahead, Malone.
And Robin Toll had a small little issue there going side by side with Helverson. Got a little bit loose there. He missed his breaking point, went straight into the the runoff there. He's going to get back on. No damage, though. He's going to get back on the track there.
What you'll likely see a lot of the time with these cars, if they're going to go wide, they'll just let the car run wide. They'll let it go around just to make sure, as we see. Oh, car being collected in the background. That looks like one of the Which car was that? Let's see if we can get a quick look at that.
I think that was Toll again.
Well, here's Robin Toll in the Aston Martin. No, he went past. There was a Lamborghini that got in the way of one of the other Lamborghinis. We didn't quite see who it was, unfortunately. But issues all around at the start. People were driving way too hard at the start of this race. You need to get into a rhythm and, you know, just be prepared.
Did these guys get the memo that this is a 24-hour race?
Just like a Toll was too wide on turning into Mulsanne corner and lost it, basically.
I'd like to say they did, but I'm not entirely sure. As we go back to the head of the field, and you see that Daniel Pizzo is just literally just sitting in the slipstream in the Corvette and not being able to get past it in that straight line. But this is where the difference is going to be. This is where the difference in the cars are going to show through here. The Corvette's going to come in there, runs a little bit wide. Daniel doesn't. Let's see how much he closes up through here.
I'll tell you what here, for Pizzo, we saw the qualifying times. He did have a better qualifying time than that with Allison in that Corvette, so it's pretty amazing to see him right up on the back here early on. We'll see how long he can keep up with him.
Yes, Jimmy goes a little bit wide going off there. Obviously, bear in mind, guys, that the Corvette is in a different class. It is not actually racing these guys at all. I guess it will race for overall position, but it's not competitive as a class compared to GT3. So at the moment, Daniel Pizzo is leading his class in third position overall. From Paznicki in the Ferrari behind him, No Fear Ferrari, and the Target Racing Gallardo in third currently. So pretty eventful first lap. We've had cars on fire, cars in the wall, and with 23 hours 54 minutes to go.
We've already lost the 42 Lamborghinis. Oh, didn't even start the race. It's already DNF'd.
So
down to 15 cars.
15 cars already. Really. Well, a good start for this race, but hopefully we don't start as we mean to go on. Hopefully people will start getting into the groove a little bit. This is the battle we're going to be watching for a while, I think, between these guys. This is going to be very interesting, but also a bit further down the field, we have, I think it was Thiago Cavallo and Salva Sardina having a little bit of a scrap. There's a big scrap, actually, for fifth. Yeah, fifth overall.
Rosenley's getting into the mix here. We've got a little three-car battle here going on, going too wide.
There you go. Three cars all together for third place, and who's got the legs in a straight line? I think it's going to be Sardina. It is, very slightly. But yeah, I think that Thiago thought about, you know, going cutting back
it
under.
Looked like it's mean.
But that was
Sardini
a bit silly.
Gets by. They were up to 175 miles an hour, and they're hard on the brakes there. Ooh, good thing they got through nice and safe. Now you got Rosenley and Cavallo going side by side now.
Cavallo falling back through the positions. It just shows you that slipstream and disadvantage it can have, especially if a car is slow in a straight line. Looks like it may be. It's still on the inside, though. Looks like it's going to give the position to the Odeon Racing team. No point fighting too hard.
That the 667 Lamborghini is running hard on the front and mediums on the rear.
So maybe some tire wear issues from those guys. Maybe a little bit too aggressive through the corners.
That really surprised me to be running hard here. It's...
Mm-hmm. Here we go. See, the car's now spread out a little bit now, kind of shuffled into where they should be. I think, let's look at the head of the field, I think that Jimmy Allison and Pizzo are still fairly close together. The Corvette is starting to put a little bit of a gap low now, with that straight line speed advantage. Just shows you the difference in qualifying and race up. The Corvette race up seems a little bit more solid than that of the Ferrari so far, but it's very early days to be saying that.
So it's such a hard track to get into a rhythm as well when you've just started a race. It's...
Definitely. Yeah, I mean, I can agree with that. I've raced here previously. It was a year ago now in a prototype. We were doing all right until my computer crashed, so it's always the way it seems. And my stint was at night, so I went out at night, and to get into that rhythm straight away was so difficult, but it's very rewarding when you did get it right.
Well, that brings up another issue is computer problems and computer issues with routers and stuff. This is such a long race here. Hopefully we don't have any issues like that, but it's definitely something you got to fight through. Just hopefully everything can stay clean and operating efficiently here.
It's something that's always in the back of your mind when you're doing these endurance races, just hoping your equipment doesn't let you down.
Yep.
I don't know if any of you guys were here for the race last year that I commentated on. It was this weird thing that was a year ago now. Definitely getting old. It may even be 2 years ago. No, it was a year ago, sorry.
You're not that old.
Yeah, not that old. Where there was a lead change for the prototype win, and it affected the championship in the end about three times in the last 2 hours, all down to technical issues. And it meant that the team, the underdog, won the championship. That was Los Rents. Unfortunately, I'm not in this championship. New season, new competitors.
And even the last season I did, we won the championship. We were just seconds away from losing it at Le Mans. It was incredible.
And TT Motorsports with that green GTR gets a little bit loose there. Gets it back on the track. Not sure if there's any damage there, but now he's battling it out with a difficult name guy in Eldon. Or Equin.
We apologize for not making more effort. We did try in the first race and it just didn't work, so we've decided that it's just for the best.
One sec, Komisarczyk, you can say it with me.
No.
Okay.
And PK.
Seeing a replay here of Paznicki going a little bit wide. Church Rouge almost going to the barrier there, and Sardino says thank you very much, I'll take that, and pulls past on the straight.
Halverson and Carvalho very close, side by side going into the first chicane there.
And I think they may have made contact there, really close to
that side
race in action. Oh my gosh.
Seems that Thiago is just going backwards at this point. Setup isn't really working that well at the moment, but long race. As you say, we are only 11 minutes into this 24-hour race. Saying that again makes me wonder why I signed up for this job.
Well, you know, I mean, these guys are out here racing, and, you know, you got to have that mindset. You know, you are racing out there. You see guys all around you. There's a part of you that racing instinct kicks in. You just want to race really hard, but these guys got to remember it is a long race. But, you know, sometimes it is kind of hard to back off a little bit. Since these guys are such, you know, great competitors, and they've raced a lot of these races, and, you know, it's a balance, you know.
I mean, there are a lot of people, and I think that our very own Mr. Bailey included, who find it very difficult to kind of come down off that 100% effort when you're driving, you know, to kind of modulate your pace, so to speak. It's a very difficult skill to acquire. I wouldn't say I'm very good at it. As Carvalho goes round at the Mulsan corner, we watched that live as he just took a little bit too much speed through there. The rear escaped him, and now he's trying to navigate and turn the car around. Hopefully, he won't get anyone's way. Spins the car around.
Yeah, he turned around as Morissette comes on through.
Yeah, just off the racing line, luckily. Yeah. But it was a little bit risky to do that, I guess.
Yeah, and another thing, you know, I'm sure some of these guys were the ones who qualified. And the way you drive for qualifying is definitely a little bit different as how you start a 24-hour race. So I wonder how many of these guys were actually, you know, qualifying and then started the first stint here. You know, that's a different dynamic as well.
Yes, indeed. And now watching Turco Valdo now. He's going to be passing Dennis Morissette soon, I think. He's a little bit quicker than these guys. So we'll keep an eye on that. It's not probably going to be the most adventurous of overtakes, but he's going to be a little bit annoyed now. Lost a lot of positions from the start, and also spun at one of the key corners of the track. And he was stationary for quite a long time as well, making sure that he could get that car spun around without affecting too many people's races. So there we go. Coming up now behind Morissette. Probably won't do anything into the Porsche curves. It's not really a corner you can overtake in, unless you're some crazy man.
Don't really want to be going side by side into these corners. Just kind of hang back and try to get a really good exit here.
Just watching that go around now. What will likely happen, we're probably seeing it very close coming out of the four chicane and maybe try and put a move up into the Dunlop chicane. You can have a tech through there, but it's very difficult because you're kind of turning and braking at the same time. It's very easy, as we saw in practice from Peter in the Sim Racing PL car, to lock up the tyres. He goes up the inside now into the first chicane. I think Darren's kind of lets him go, kind of knows that he's a little bit quicker. Doesn't want to fight out too much, and they're kind of going from there. But this is the sort of race that is going to really benefit the guys who are kind of chilling, you know what I mean, at the back. Not going too quickly, keeping the car in one piece, keeping it on the track. Those are the guys that are going to benefit the most in this sort of race.
Yeah, and we got Robin Toll heading into the pits now. Pretty early pit stop, not sure what's going on there.
So Robin Toll on the pit. I see if we have any sort of... we do have enough track from him. Let's see if we can get that replay. Here it is.
He'd have to spin it in Mulsanne corner as well. So.
That's just him coming into the pits, it seems. I'm trying to find, why he came in. If there's any footage. Oh, it looks like, there you go, it's Porsche curves. He came on to the left hander, went a bit too quick, and just hit the wall on the outside, causing some sort of damage, and now he's coming to the pits to make sure nothing's done. Probably a good idea at this stage, really, to make sure the car is okay, and we'll keep running, you know.
Well, such a long, long lap here. You don't want to risk being out there, you know, with the car not handling the way it could be. And, you know, just pull it on in, get things fixed up, head back out.
Definitely. And here's our lead overall leader, Rafael Astroza, in the Target Racing AMR. Just, I imagine, putting in laps at this point. I have to admire the decision to remain in this race, considering that they are the only P1 car in the race at this point. And they will be for the rest of the race. And just about keeping it clean for them. It looks like he's attacking, though. I guess the car really working for them at the moment, putting in 3.15s. 313, sorry, in qualifier in race trim, so the car is working very well for them at the moment. See if we can get a speed trap read from them coming down the straight, shall we?
Well, for their pace, it's better for them to actually push on, so they've got something to concentrate on. See, they're not racing anyone.
That's right.
212 miles an hour going in there.
Really very fast down that straight, just showing the grunt of the P1 cars down there.
And really, Pizzo is not too far off from Jimmy Allison still. Jimmy Allison in that Corvette. But Pizzo, man, he is just flying out there. We saw him in qualifying. You know, did have the better time, and he's pretty much sort of keeping up with that Corvette. I know it's a different class and everything, but that's pretty impressive here.
Well, I've just put up on the screen the three drivers between the Corvette of Jimmy Allison, the Ferrari of Sardina, and the Ferrari of Pasnicki. And I've been watching the gap between first and second in the GTs, and I think that Pasnicki is actually gaining a little bit on Sardina.
Right, last lap, Sardina did the fastest lap of the GT3 so far at 56.6.
So he's on a charge trying to catch up. Sorry, it was Daniel Pizzo and Sardino I meant, sorry, not Pasnicki. Pasnicki is being left a little bit by Sardino at the moment with that pace. But you can't really be watching Pizzo, and in the background you see Sardino starting to close in, but we'll have to see how that goes. And just watching the
lap
times now.
Yeah, I would imagine these guys being teammates here, if Sardino does catch up to Pizzo, I don't anticipate any fireworks there. If Sardinia happens to be faster, maybe Pizzo just lets him by. We'll see how that plays out.
Yeah, we saw that before, didn't we? We saw it with the who was it last race with the Northern Light cars when they came across each other. They would just let each other go, and then Sebring as well, you know, just letting each other go when they came across each other. But yeah, I'm interested in what you said earlier. The Corvette isn't getting away, is it? It's still there. It's still being chased, and I think that we might see, as the fuel runs down, the Ferrari maybe starting to close in on that Corvette.
Yeah, and I think it just happens to do with these real tight corners and some of the snaky turns here with some of the S's here. That Corvette just isn't really as nimble as some of these other GT cars. So I think that's the difference in timing there. It allows the Pizzo to kind of keep up a little bit.
Yeah, I mean, we noticed, didn't we, Bear, the GTs, the GT3 cars are a lot quicker coming off the corners, well, not quicker,
massively,
but
so,
you know, a lot more competitive coming off the corners than the GT car. Sorry, so
not to interrupt you, but Didrich just had an issue there. He was off the racing line into the grass. Doesn't look like he got any damage from that.
He's
currently
bringing up a replay now.
Eighth place overall. Sixth place in this class.
There you go. You just see it coming up the Dunlop curve, and the car just snapped to the right. And very nearly in the wall, but just avoided it as we go back to Daniel Pizzo. 280.7 kilometers an hour down the straight. Just hear that Corvette rumble as it goes into the distance. Very, very awesome. And we did say this before, we'll say it again though, that the Corvette belongs to the URD mod, the EGT mod. which is going to be used entirely, not just that car, the whole range of cars, which includes, you know, Vipers, Ferraris, Aston Martins, Z4s, and eventually will also include prototypes as well. That'll be a separate mod, but they'll be put into one, and they're going to be used for season 7. So this is its kind of, this is its trial by fire, you know, sticking it in the mold, see how it handles, see how it goes. And I'm very excited to see the results for that car, because I'm a big fan of the EGT mod. I think it's a brilliant mod. I think it's probably the best thing you can drive in sim racing at the moment. And really looking forward to driving it next year, because I'm definitely going to be competing next year. That car's definitely going to be there.
Yeah, and you talk about testing a car. Well, this is definitely a stress test for any type of car, any type of driver here. So, yeah, we'll know a lot more. More information will be coming in after this race for sure, because this is definitely a good way to test the car.
And we're seeing it now already that the Corvette is, or the URD mod is doing very well. Maybe a bit slower than you would think with the tyres wearing down. The tyres are very sensitive in that Corvette. And if you're scrubbing along the circuit, trying to drive a little bit too fast, getting understeer, then you'll know about it very quickly. I mean, Mr. Bailey took part in the race yesterday at Indianapolis in the Porsche from that mod, same tyre model. And chose not to take new tyres at the end. And would you like to tell me how that car handled towards the end, Bailey?
Say it was by the end, it was about 4 seconds a lap slower than it could have been. That car. It was.
I mean, for comparison, someone else that hopefully will be joining us in the booth at some point, Oscar Hardwick, was in that race as well. He was in second place. He chose to take tyres, and from a 20-second gap from the pit stop to the end was reduced to, was it just over a second at the end?
Yeah, by the end.
So he gained 18 and a half seconds by taking tyres. That's a difference that tyres can make in that car. So it's very important to have those behaving at all points.
And as we see, taking a look at Souza here, getting past Halvorsen, looks like the P1 car is around and starting to lap now some of the GT cars.
So if that's Halvorsen, he's up already into the sharp end of the GT field. Let's see how compliant they are. They don't really need to be. There's no issue for the P1 car, so we'll see what the P1 car does here. That'll be interesting, actually. I mean, if you guys were race control and you saw that the P1 car is being held up by the DT car despite it not racing anyone, what would your attitude be towards that?
It's a very good question. In its own class, it's not racing anyone. Even as the P1 driver, I think you'd be inclined to be a little more careful than you probably would be in a typical race.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, there's no need to get up alongside someone in the chicane or anything. Best thing Souza can do is just make his pass on exit and let these GT cars run their race.
That's right. And just to very quickly let you guys know, throughout the stream we will be restarting the stream every 2 hours, so well, every 2.5 hours we're going to start from the start of the race, so 24 hours, so about 21:30 or so, maybe a bit before that, we're going to restart the stream just so we can upload it to YouTube, have it in parts, have it there so you guys can watch it at your leisure. So just to give you guys a forewarning of that, Twitch isn't too great when it comes to uploading videos to YouTube, unfortunately, so that's how we're going to deal with it, but it won't affect your viewing at all. Just a quick stop and start, and we'll be going again.
Yep, that's right. And so those will be being uploaded to the Grip TV Live YouTube. Might as well head on over to youtube.com/GripTVLive now. Give it a subscribe, and that way you'll be able to see those videos pop up. You'll get the notification. Also, don't forget about the Grip TV Live Facebook, and we are taking your questions, guys, at Grip TV Live Twitter account. So if you got a question, go ahead and send it to @GripTVLive Twitter, and we'll be able to answer those live here on the stream during the broadcast.
Do we have anything in yet for that, or are we still dry?
Well, we did have a little something here from Ryan Walker. He says, do you think anyone will be doing the Malone wheel wiggle?
I'm sure we'll see a couple of those going into the Porsche Cars if it goes wrong, especially we saw some guy do it earlier, I think. So That is possible, but we'll miss it, unfortunately, because we haven't got a webcam. Although we have got a little bit of a treat for you guys. We haven't been able to show it off just yet, because he's not actually racing. But one of the racers, I think one of the Garza drivers, I forget what team he's on now. I'm going to get murdered for that. But it's Rinus Jansens, and he has set up a webcam for us. appear kind of behind the shoulder type thing of his, you know, his free screens, his Fanatec wheel. So we'll be able to show him on screen when he's driving. So a little bit of a treat for you guys later on to make sure you stick around for the full 24 hours of Le Mans here over at Grip TV. Just getting started, guys. Not even half an hour in yet. Plenty more to go, so make sure you stick around.
So I think the real question should be, are we going to see the Malone shifter snap?
We might do.
I hope not, for the sake of these guys' equipment.
I think the best part of that video is when you... The oh. I've broken that. I'm sure... we're going to be fairly kind of on it in terms of racing and coverage here, but it is going to be a kind of relaxed stream. We aren't going to be too I'm going to like this for the whole race, because I think that my voice will just give out before before we get to the next hour. So if you guys have anything you want to chat about, anything that's on topic relatively, anything points you want to bring up, make sure you put that in chat, or as Malone said, head over to the Grip TV Live Twitter and post a question there, and we'll do our best to answer it, again, if it is relevant and not rude.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, we got the full about 70 people watching here live on Twitch, and we got the Twitch chatter going. So, yeah, whatever you guys want to bring up here, we got our eyes on you. So, yeah, I just want to thank everybody for watching. It's fun hanging out. We all like racing. We all like watching racing, and this should be a really fun day. I'm having a blast up here in the booth with you guys.
Well, that reminds me, Malone, I actually bought some diet lemonade the other day. I couldn't go with the hard lemonade because my body can't take it, because I'm not a man. I don't work with concrete. So I had to get some diet lemonade, and I've got that on tap later on for when I get into the later hours. It's my treat for being awake for however long I'm going to be awake for. There you go.
Yep.
Fun times. As you watch Jimmy Anderson now go through the Dunlop chicane, just going down the hill again to the Forest Essers. That Corvette looking very lovely and very planted. Still not too far behind, though, is Daniel Pizzo and Salvo Sardina. Still within range. Sardina is now only 1.6 seconds behind.
Sardina's just done two laps in a row within a thousandth of a second.
How's that for consistency, guys? That's what you want round here. You want that consistency for real. So being told, Darius Morissette has just gone off track. Let's see what happened here. Here's a replay of it. Probably going to be just a little bit of a wide line through the Fort Chicane. Here it is. Looks like he might have just clipped one of the curbs. We'll stay on board for a second. Sometimes the replays take a little bit longer to kick in here. We're still getting used to this broadcast tool, so bear in mind that before you give us any, let's say, mild criticism as he comes up to the Dunlop chicane. Looks like all is in order. Looks like it's just a very brief off going into the Ford chicane. Nothing to write home about. We did have a video prepared of... Well, Mr. Bailey going round here in a fairly quick time of 3:53, I believe. I think it's 52.5 off the top of my head. Probably incorrect. Was that
53.1?
One, actually.
It all matters,
it does. And we were going to show that. I think what we'll do instead is next time we get round to next lap, we'll go on board with you, Maz, and we'll talk you through the lap, talk you through, I think Bailey will be good for it as well. I'm not going to do the whole thing, don't worry. It's just a discussion. And what kind of challenges he's facing in that cockpit. And we see here that Matt HP85 is saying he's quite tempted to go to Le Mans next week. If I had that choice, I'd be there in a flash, my friend. But luckily, I'm doing the typical man thing when it comes to sports, where I'm picketing the front room. It's my front room now. No one can go in there. All my friends are coming around. We're going to have our beer. We're going to have our ridiculously salty snacks. And I'm watching them on 24 hours on various different screens, because one screen is not enough, ladies and gentlemen. It's definitely not enough. It's going to be fantastic fun. And I'll also be, just a quick plug for me here, because why not, I'll be doing a race diary like I did last year, Le Mans race diary, like a video log style. You can find that on my YouTube channel, which is Jimmy Broadbent on YouTube. Just search it and you'll likely find it. And another awesome, hopefully awesome, race diary for there, as Jimmy Anderson goes flying through Indianapolis. That car looks so quick through there, but it looks so planted compared to the other cars.
Yeah, I know. I always check out your YouTube for the Mod Center, as far as, you know, R Factor 2. They got, you know, the regular content. Guys are always making new content, and you know, sometimes you're on the fence about whether or not to download and try it out, but head on over. You know, you do a great review, because you've been doing this a lot for quite a while, so you know the ins and outs of R-Factor, so I was always interested to check those out.
Yeah, Malone's iRacing, I'm R-Factor, so No, we all live in a house for a funny sitcom, so you know that's how we go. And okay, so we'll pop aboard Jimmy Addison now. See if I can find my Karen button. It's around here somewhere. There it is. Nothing but professionalism here at Grip TV.
We are well prepared.
So here we are now, coming up to the fourth chicane for the last part of his last lap. Not too far down on his best so far, about half a second down. You're going to see that come down a little bit as the tyres start to wear. But you see, just taking the chicane. Look how soft he is on the steering. You have to be soft in this car, or the tyres will wear. So that chicane is fantastic to go over in this car. Kind of start a new lap. You're looking at your lap time on the right just to make sure you're still kind of running well. 6 tenths down, so he's going to want to try and lap a little bit quicker this lap, not too quick. Try and position the car on the inside here, and kind of let it get as far right as you can in your braking to go for the left hander for the Dunlop chicane and the right hander again. Taking a little bit too much there, Jimmy. Come on, Mr. Mod, what are you doing? Within the white lines, please. Coming down now to the Forest Estate. You're all the way over to the right hand side of the course. Momentum is important through here. You can go through here in third in this car if you get it right. A little bit wide on the entry, not so bad on the exit. Hitting that little bump that you go over there. Very easy to get into the wall if you're not careful through there. And now Tetra Rouge just getting on the inside again. Initial understeer I saw there, Bailey, going into the corner and on the exit as well. Maybe the front tyre starting to warm up a little bit.
It's the Corvette there, when you try and take it in fourth gear, and it does tend to push ahead a little bit over the curb. It's really tricky to get right.
Definitely now, and we're going down to the PlayStation chicane, getting up to 180 plus miles an hour down here. Looking for our braking mark on the left hand side. There's the 400, there's the 300. And braking just before the 100 meter mark, very late brakes there, kind of breaking all the way through that the corner. That was very late on the brake. Yeah, you see, made a mistake there actually, trying to be a bit too adventurous through there.
But 185 miles an hour going into there.
Yeah, maybe he's wishing it wasn't that fast when he went into there now, because it cost him a little bit of time. And you heard the tyres lock up as well. That's going to be some unwanted wear. I can pretty much guarantee you that. Got a yellow flag in the first sector. We'll keep an eye on that. Oh, it's gone now, so I guess someone just maybe went off the course. And now you see he's moved over to the right-hand side of the track. This one's a very different sort of braking zone. You kind of brake all the way into the corner here. You come off the brakes a little bit here, and then you dab the brakes again just to make sure you get the car around. The car understeering again. Jimmy, I think maybe with warm, hot tyres, a warm front tyre, sorry, after going through that PlayStation chicane in an interesting fashion. As we now go down the last part of the straight, coming up to Mulsanne Corner, this little kind of little hump in the curb there. We've seen cars do interesting things like this in real life. Hopefully we won't see that here. And again, very difficult braking zone. You kind of brake just after the kink. And then second gear user through here. We've seen Jimmy using first. He does again use first. Second gear better for momentum, but Jimmy's obviously more comfortable in first there, so we won't judge him. They're going very wide, almost touching that barrier on the left there. Not quite wanting to do that.
Far too close for comfort.
Definitely. I've done that many times. This car, very easy to go wide in this car. They're trying to be soft, so see that again. Jimmy didn't lose too much time, actually, off that. But I've just noticed that
We get a battle in the back with Morissette, Carvello, and Diedrich. It's a three-car battle. Carvello just got around Morissette.
So we'll come away from that for a second. But Carvello actually was actually faster anyway, so I'm not too surprised to see that happen. What's he doing back there again? Did he make another mistake? He must have done.
I know Diedrich made a mistake spinning, but now he's battling out this side-by-side action, Diedrich and Morissette.
We're actually on board now with Diedrich, and we can see to the left of us Morissette. Oh, this is an interesting place for the overtake manoeuvre. Morissette breaking really late, and Morissette did really well to defend that then. He had the outside line, out-braked Diedrich, and went around the outside to defend his position. But now, both in the R right here, both in the very high-pitch-sounding car, coming down the straight. What's going to happen here, guys?
Well, Diedrich in the slipstream, yep.
Again, side by side now, coming up to Indianapolis. I'm sure that Thiago is very glad that he's not involved in this anymore. But it looks like the Morissette's running slightly lower wing because Diedrich can't get past.
In the slipstream.
Mm-hmm.
And Carvello's got to have a big old smile on his face seeing these guys battling it out. He's trying to create a gap.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. Yeah, there's that wiggle coming out of Indianapolis now, going, all right, up the inside of Arnage, and Morissette really has no choice but to get out of the way. A very, I guess, aggressive move by there, by Dietrich. Not quite dangerous, but just very firm. I'm taking the position now. I'll be going. Thank you very much. And Dietrich moves up into ninth place overall, I think it is. And seventh place in the GTs. So good job there. We missed out the end of Jimmy Addison's lap, unfortunately, but you get an idea of what it's like. Very soft on the tyres you need to be. just sort of looking through the chat at the moment, and not much going on in there. They're asking about Allison, I think.
Jimmy lost our second to Pizzo on that lap. The mistake down in the chicane.
He did indeed, and I think that Corvette at the moment is a bit faster. Not seeing Sardina catching him on pace at the moment, although they aren't too dissimilar though. But it will only take a little mistake like that for stuff to go wrong.
Absolutely. Sardina's been very consistent, 57.9, 57.5, 57.5, 58.2, and 57.8 again.
And here he is, speak of the devil. Maybe just holding station at the moment, do you think? Not wanting to get involved with the teammate. This sort of area, there is no dirty air to speak of. There really is in these cars anyway. Not in the slipstream, just kind of chilling behind his teammate, making sure there's no drama, especially at this point in the race where we're still under the hour mark.
And Sousa coming on into the pits, and man, that is a tough pit entrance to navigate through. Very tight. Almost rubbed some of the wall there, but Sousa's into the pits here.
He is indeed showing, I think, the small fuel tank of the prototype, and he hasn't got much to worry about in terms of how long he stays in the pit for. He's got to make sure he gets back out there in some sort of time and, you know, just get back on the track. Likely they'll be taking tyres and fuel. There's not much point them, you know, taking anything that isn't going to benefit them for speed, because they are running on their own. Same for the Corvette, I think.
That's only a 10-lap stint on the tank for the P1 car. That's really not long at all.
Yeah, and just a reminder for everybody, Pablo Flores and Peter Munkholm are out of the race. Peter with that engine blown. But we got 15 cars still running out there. So 15 cars total still running.
Indeed, and chat saying that when the prototypes for the URD mod are released, this is going to be a different kind of league. Going to be a completely a new step. I totally agree with that, and I am very much looking forward to driving a car next year. I think the hard choice is going to be what car I choose, you know. It's going to be
a
difficult time.
I don't like at the moment. Well, yeah. Allison wide coming out of Arnage. He's just going to get passed.
There it is. Very wide, it seems, because he's lost a lot of time out there. See if we can get a replay of what happened there. But now he's now sitting behind Mr. Pizzo. Finally, I'm sure Pizzo's thinking. Oh, here it is. Yeah, Allison just gets onto the grass, and that allows Pizzo to get through. But Pizzo was quite close anyway, I think. I guess he gained a bit of time through there.
Yeah, he was. Man, good thing Allison didn't get into that barrier there. It was pretty close. Not a whole lot of runoff room there. But he gets it back on the track here, but that does allow Pizzo to get by.
It just looked like Jimmy was too late on the brakes.
Yeah, it's the second time we've seen that in a couple of laps from Jimmy. Maybe the tyres and the brakes starting to heat up a little bit too much for him. Maybe he should start working on cooling those down a bit before getting into the later stints. Just watching now. But it's come round now for the first time leading all the GTs, including the GTE car of the Corvette. And I think Sardina's going to have a go next.
I was going to say, Sardina now right up on Allison. Allison getting through that chicane. Sardina cut a lot of that chicane there. Cheating just a little bit, but it's all right.
Yeah, I mean, there are, just to quickly go over that, there are no kind of official rules as far as it goes with the chicane at the end. It's all about just getting through there cleanly. If you get the cut track from the R-Factor, that's when you have to slow down, as Jimmy makes a little bit of a mistake going down to the first of the 4SS, and now Sardina's right behind. We're going to go on board and Sardina now and just show the difference of the speed between the Corvette here and the Ferrari. So just sitting now on the bonnet of the Ferrari. Even in the slipstream, the Corvette is just staying ahead. I think it's going to start pulling away soon as the Ferrari gets into its limiter. Well, the Ferrari doing 290 kilometers an hour and goes to outbreak the Corvette. I think the Corvette lets him go. But I think that's for the best. Jimmy doesn't want to really get in the way of the battle ahead, I don't think. Probably doing the better thing, seeing as he's in part of that class, but his car's not too slow in the slipstream, apparently.
I've seen Jimmy miss sort of three or four different braking zones in the last couple of laps.
There it is. And the C6 car now going to be behind in the sit stream of Sardina now. So what's going to happen next? Will we see him maybe come back past, or do you think he was just going to leave it?
I don't know. He might. It looks like he's really losing ground now.
Yeah,
anyway.
I think he's too far back now to think about it. I think the tyres are done. I think he needs to come in and get them sorted out. But we'll see.
I'd be surprised if he's cooked his tyres already.
Well, it does look like it, the way
he's
driving.
He's really struggling with the front end.
And yeah, again, look at that massive lock-up going down to Mulsanne Corner. So that tyre is now going to be even worse than it was before. Sorry to cut you over there, Malone, but that was pretty much the entire length of that corner. He was just smoke, so...
Right. I mean, 9 laps in, I mean, if he was able to keep it nice and smooth, he might be okay, but he has definitely had some issues, and that will definitely cause some tyre wear a little bit more than usual, so... Maybe be looking for Allison to be pitting here soon, you think?
Possibly. I mean, he's not going to lose anything by doing so, but we'll have to see. Just notice that Dietrich and Morissette are still very close together, coming out through the Michelin chicane. And Morissette actually gets a little bit of a run on Dietrich now, as Dietrich is a little bit loose coming out of the Michelin chicane. Just going to get on the throttle a bit too early, and very close together now coming down to Mulsanne. And we saw before that Morissette has a bit of a faster car on a straight line than Dietrich does, so this could be interesting coming down to this next complex. Coming over the hump now, coming down to the Mulsanne corner. See that big tyre mark there from Jimmy Allison, just laid down just now. See if we can get on board with Morissette. Here we are. See if we can see what kind of difference in speed there is. Does look like we're gaining very slightly, not enough to be close enough for Indianapolis, I don't think, though. And Indianapolis isn't really an overtaking spot anyway, unless you were a very crazy son of a gun.
Crazy would be the right word.
But there, the slip stream and the top speed advantage definitely coming into play there. A lot closer than it was before at the start of the straight, that's for sure, but nothing you can do there to take that position back. Back to Arnage now. Seems that that target car is a little bit better in the tighter corners so far. Maybe a characteristic of the setup.
So when he passed, he got really good traction off Indianapolis, passing him to Arnage.
Mm-hmm. So it's all about that, and that's where I think what's happening here is we're seeing the target car get away, and then the straights come round, and the Can-Am car just pulls it back in again. That's why setup's so interesting. See that bump for yourself there when you're on board with Dennis there. Just how pronounced it is going for that corner. Got to be very careful. Look how much of a gap that, you know, he's pulled out now over Dennis, now that they're in kind of the target car territory.
That is a substantial advantage now. You can almost read the logos on the rear end of the other 80 before the Porsche curves.
Yeah, now you need to get your telescope out and hope for the best. Trying to start another lap now. This is lap 10, I believe, for these cars, as we see Swoz from the background just pop into the frame. He's going to get past these guys, probably, maybe, I don't know, where I think Morissette's going to be taken before the Dunlop chicane and Dietrich after. Actually, no, just, you see the prototype just giving them room there, slowing down quite a bit, I think. They're very kind of him to do that, but maybe a bit too much. No, the traction is enough just to pull past. I underestimate how fast these P1 cars are compared to DT cars sometimes.
That's an incredible difference. A couple of times when they came up with me in practice, I didn't even hear them coming until they were past me.
Mm-hmm. Definitely. See if we're getting on board quickly with Lucas as the car goes past him. We'll see the difference. Here it is. Bam! And that's gone. That ain't coming back.
Yeah, you know, with only the one P1 car out there, these guys, you know, hopefully they don't forget about Sousa out there, you know, and... You know, they got to be checking their mirrors every once in a while to make sure they remember he's out there, because he comes up fast.
Absolute missile of a car, that P1 car compared to these. And just looking in the background for that Can-Am car, and it's not as close as it was last lap. I think it lost a little bit too much time going through the last part of the course to be close enough to challenge through here. Maybe Lucas made a mistake in the last lap, because it seems that target car is a bit faster at the moment.
definitely losing ground, even on this section of the track where it's been quicker.
That's right. But elsewhere on track, we have Pasnicki and Pere Rosalie not too far apart, but you have about a second between each other. Sim Racing PL team there, and the Odeon Racing team, winners of the last time out at Long Beach, taking the 25-point total. Not much in the grand scheme of things to win a sprint race. This point worth this race with 100 points, I believe, to the winners. So obviously, this race a lot more important to win than Long Beach. At the moment, it's looking good for the GT Italia guys, but we're not even an hour in yet. Anything can happen at the moment, it usually does.
So we've just had Robin Toll take 30th place overall from the TT Motorsport GTR.
Yeah, I'm keeping my eye on Eklund and Kevin Wood here. Eklund, if he closes the gap just a little bit more, he'll be into that slipstream, and it could get interesting after that. Eklund right now running 12th overall, so we'll see.
We'll see if we can get a lap time comparison quickly. And so we'll,
yeah.
Because that would be interesting to see if you guys maybe have a look at the lap time and see what kind of times they're running together. Because if Jay Eklund is in fact closing on Kevin Wood, and like you said, yeah, slipstream will be coming up soon. And with these big old straights here at Cirque du Soleil, that really is a massive factor getting that closeness. It's like it's almost like DRS here, to mention something that is evil among race fans. But
right, yeah, almost a full second off. Kevin Wood ran a 4:04 last lap, and Eklund ran a 4:03. So Kevin Wood's got to pick it up here just a little bit so he doesn't get too much pressure from Eklund.
It looks like they've been fairly evenly matched up until the last couple of laps, really.
Yeah, it could be tire issue for Kevin, or, you know, hopefully it's not a loss of concentration.
He just ran wide.
A little bit wide there, yeah. So Eklund now is getting real close to that slipstream. Things could be heating up here soon.
And Kevin Wood in that Red Weasel Racing Aston Martin. I think it's the only Aston out here. Correct me if I'm wrong again. I usually am. But here comes the Ferrari now of Jay Eklund in that same HQ car. Usually running the red car, deciding to run a kind of grey car for Le Mans, maybe a different paint scheme for the big race, so to speak. A lot of cars do that in real life. This is the ARC car, the Aston Martin ARC car, the very glorious prototype from last year. I forget what team it was that I very much like the paint scheme of, and was pretty much kicked out of TeamSpeak for doing so.
Issues.
Issues with that. But yeah, you can see that how close Jay Eklund is now, and I think if he can get a good run through the chicane here, we might be on the back of him coming through the coming up to the straight.
Yeah, Eklund's just got to worry about his exit speed here, slow in, fast out, and he may be able to get right up on Wood there. But I would imagine Kevin Wood's starting to, you know, look in his rearview mirror here.
We had an overtake somewhere. Who it was? It was Dennis Morrison overtaking.
Again.
Yeah, and Lucas went wide in Indianapolis, and I think he might have actually scraped the wall a little bit, but that let Dennis back through again. So those R8s at it, hammer and tong. I'm sure Lucas would be a bit further up the field if he could just keep it on the track. But at the moment, he's having real issues doing that. So fingers crossed for him, I guess, as the race goes on.
I imagine we're heading towards the first round of pit stops for the GTs any time soon. We're on, what, the 12th lap now for them.
Mm-hmm. Here he comes now, in a straight line. I have to excuse me having the cheeky hour apple to keep my spirits up. And I think that if there's a good run through this first chicane, then that Ferrari could be in for a chance coming down to Mulsanne, maybe. We will see.
So inching closer, isn't he?
Yeah, it's getting there.
And we do have a new question in at Grip TV Live Twitter from Trevor. Is there any LMP1 cars in this race? He just got into the stream and he wants to know.
In this league, there are usually quite a few LMP1 cars, but unfortunately, due to circumstances beyond control, other commitments, etc., we only have the one running in this race. So that's why we're not showing them at the moment, because they're just running on their own. They're running at laps. It's the Target Racing car, and we'll keep an eye on them as the race goes on. But they're the guys running at the moment. There is only the DT1 GT kind of battle going on. There is also another class, the GTE class, with one car in as well, and that is being run by Jimmy Allison currently, who is at the moment, from what I see, in fourth overall, yet to pit, despite having the tire issues.
Yeah, and we're looking at, I'm looking at Rafael Souza right now in that P1 car, our only one there, and he's coming up right on the back of Allison here, see if he can get by safe. He's been doing pretty good. He's very patient. You know, if he comes up on a group of GT cars, he just kind of lets them do their thing and passes them on exit, which is good to see. What do you got?
So after just watching how quick he was going past.
Yeah. Yeah, the difference in speed is pretty amazing here. Even getting past the Corvette there. The Corvette's a little bit faster even, so... yeah, interesting little mix of cars. There's just a couple of different cars, but... yeah, it is fun to watch.
One thing I'm noticing is that the GT3s take the curbs in the Ford chicane so much better than the Corvette can.
Yeah, I think through experience as well, the curbs are really a no-no for the Corvette if you're trying to be quick, especially on entry to corners as well. Like, exit's not so bad, but entry, you have to really have that tarmac under you. Just been told by Timo that we have the quality option now on the stream, which seems to have a nice crowd, a nice audience, which is, I can't see the exact number, but thank you guys for being here and joining us. 78 people with us, that's a ridiculous number. Thank you for joining us, guys, and make sure to stick here for unparalleled GT action. It's going to be GT action, unfortunately, for the rest of the 24 hours of the morning. We are nearly an hour in, so time is flying.
And it looks like Eklund is getting close to Mr. Wood there. These guys have been running pretty good here, 10th and 11th, 11th and 12th, sorry, overall here. Kevin Wood and Jay Eklund. If Eklund, he's in the slipstream now.
He's got it now.
Yeah.
So, yeah, be watching this battle on screen. Eklund makes a mistake for the first game.
No.
I didn't see if he went round or not. I think he might have done because he just dropped off my screen. Yeah, he did go around.
Yeah, he went around, kept it off the wall, though, which is good.
Here's the replay of it.
He gets back on track and gets back up to race pace here. So, man, now he's got to close the gap again all over.
I bet he's kicking himself. We just hit that inside curb and he came to a stop in the wrong, like the worst place as well. He was facing that wall. I had to reverse out of it. And you can see now that gap between them is just right back up again. I'm sure he's really not very happy with that at all. But Kevin Wood, I'm sure, wiping the sweat from his brow. Thank you very much. I'll be off.
Yeah, now Wood can definitely keep his eyes focused on the track instead of his rearview mirror, that's for sure.
That's right, and just watching the rest of the field now, looks like Lucas now coming back again up to the back of Dennis. These guys still fighting. A little bit of a while for him to get there though, after his mistake at Indianapolis, but I think he'll be in the back sooner or later.
And Lucas's laps have been all over the place in the race so far. It's got 4.11s, 4.07s, 4.04s, 4.01s, 4 minutes. It's
definitely
really all over the shop.
I mean, we're just watching Lucas now. And what we noted before is that, it's now in my notes, so it's definitely a real thing, is that that Can-Am car is very fast in a straight line, so all this time going down the straight, he's just losing time. He has to make it all up in the corners, and at the moment, he's just not doing that. He's putting it wide here and there, you know, he's not being consistent. It could be the case, it could be the rear tyres are too hot, very easy to do that in these cars. Seen running the white tyre there, which is the medium tyre. Just trying, you know, maybe the hard tyre, the better option for these guys next stint. Maybe, I mean, it's surprising, you have to very much, you know, abuse the tires very hard to get onto that high tire. Looks like he's kind of doing that at the moment, so you see him weaving all over the place, coming out of corners, just smashing the throttle. Looks like maybe just getting
his braking looked awful as well. Car is weaving left and right, looks a real handful.
Yeah, just guys, I did see that Peter Monkholm was in our waiting booth as well. I was told he was in our waiting booth. Unfortunately, I missed it because I was kind of in the stream and all my TeamSpeak sounds are off, so you guys don't have to hear them. So if anyone is in the waiting room, please either let me know on the Twitch chat, or one of you guys, if you see it, just let me know and I'll bring them in. Or you guys can do it as well, because we all have the power to do so. So anyone who wants
the power. Or any of the other teammates, because, you know, we got driver swaps here. We got a lot of the teammates watching, you know, rooting for their guy. If they want to jump on and, you know, have a little talk with us, that'd be awesome too.
Always very interested to hear from anyone in the race or anyone who has any insight to what the teams are doing, by all means jump in. We do have a couple of other guest commentators lined up as well, so you know, diversity is the name of the game here today.
This is such a long race. We're gonna need some help getting through as much as we can.
Yeah, because it's always interesting to hear from the different teammates, because I know some of these guys are talking with each other.
Oh, sorry, Malone. Lucas Dittrich is getting very loose coming out of the on the Porsche curves and putting it into the wall in a big way, very hard there. See if we can get an onboard replay of that, but he's now stationary on track. Looks like he might have stalled the car. Let's see if he's going to get going again before we get the replay up. Yeah, car's going again, so it looks like he stalled it, but put it in the wall big, very hard. Very, very bad, unfortunately, for him there. So we'll see if we can get a replay of that on screen.
Looks like he got on the throttle a little bit too early there. Got two tires off and just couldn't make it back on the racetrack.
And we're on board now, yeah. Goes over the curb, like you said. Just gets on the track, spins it into the wall. Hits the wall about 80 miles an hour or so, sideways. And yeah, that's going to be a pit stop for sure. And yeah, he does stall it. He obviously smashing the buttons trying to get going again. I think it's very easy to do that when rolling backwards in the car to stall the car. And that's going to be...
Yeah, he's pulling it into the pits now and get that thing checked out.
That's going to be a blow to his race.
The car looked like a handful just to get into the pit lane itself. Never mind keep driving around.
Yeah, that's not... I mentioned it before. That's not an easy pit entrance, especially if you're dealing with a little bit of damage there.
Something I've noticed now, sorry, is that Robin Toll is now on the back of Jay Eklund. Obviously, after Jay Eklund's mistake, losing a bit of time. And now Robin Toll on that rare endurance team, Gallardo, is pulling up to the back. This will be for ninth place in the GTs.
Looking at Toll's lap, so he should get by reasonably quickly. He seems to have quite a lot of pace over Eklund.
Well, here's what will be done. Coming up now to Tetra Rouge and the what will be the Multan straight, and he's going to be sitting in that slipstream. Probably just going to drive past him, but we'll see. Actually, it looks like he's got
getting a little loose there.
I think they both did actually.
And Rare Endurance, their team is currently fifth place in the standings. So, Robin Toll, if he can get past this guy, that'd be good for him here. I know Eklund had his issues.
Maybe they're not quite as happy where they are at the moment, but here we go. Coming down into the pace station. Quite far behind the side-by-side now. Breaking late. I think Jay's going to contest it. He does. He breaks late and goes around, defends the line. Maybe he's not willing to give up this place. But yeah, but if I were Jay, I'd be looking at the lap times, how quick Robin has caught me, thinking, is this worth me fighting or not? And I'd probably let him go of it with me. But we'll see. Jay not letting up just yet. Obviously showing that he's got a bit of fight left in him yet, and Robin's going to go up the inside now, coming up to the Michelin chicane. I think it's going to be passing him by the time we get there. There it is. The position has changed on our screen. Just passed him now, but who's going to break later again? Yeah, I think Robin's got him now.
72 miles an hour for Toll there.
I think that... And oh, hello. That was scary. I just saw that coming to the screen there. I think... They did very well to avoid him now. I saw him at the last second, so if I were in that car, I would have crashed straight into him, it seems. But let's see if we can get a replay of what happened there. The replay function is working now, and well, so we're happy.
Yeah, Kevin Wood gets loose there, tries to correct it, countersteer, and it just didn't work for it. Then he just kind of sits there, lets those guys go by, so good heads up there. Man, that could have been a head-on collision there. That was when you see a car pointed the wrong way, it's never good. But Kevin Wood doesn't get any damage. He gets it back going there.
That looked like a very weird crash. It was very low speed, I think. So maybe just the car was already loose before you know he got there. So see of that. But these guys still going at it as Jay Eklund now in the slipstream in that Ferrari. I don't think he's going to be close enough to do anything through here. I wouldn't try it anyway.
Yeah, so now a little bit of shuffling around there. That puts Robin Toll in 8th place overall, Jay Eklund 9th, and Kevin Wood 10th.
I always love watching these GT cars go through Indianapolis. They just kind of drift through at the back. Must be bad for the tyres, though. They really do abuse the car through there. It's really brilliant to watch. So we're going to go back quickly to have a look at our victim, the 13th place GT car of Lucas Dittrich. Having that big incident at the Porsche curve, now back on track, same car, same driver. The car seems to be okay now, so the damage has been fixed, but maybe there'll be some underlying downforce damage. We do see that sometimes in the sim. I mean, very hard to get past that. I mean, you can end up losing, you know, tens of miles per hour down the straight with that downforce damage. I'm sure you guys have experienced that before in your respective sims.
Absolute nightmare, I can tell you. Yeah. Very frustrating.
Just want to mention 13th overall TT Motorsports GTR did get off track, bumped the wall. I'm going to keep my eye on him and see if he enters the pits here. Got into the barrier, and he's going pretty slow now. I'm not too sure if he's got damage.
Was that TT Motorsports, sorry?
Yes.
Yeah, TT Motorsports.
Have a look, we have the event here. So, coming through, what did you say, through Indianapolis, sorry? There it is.
So a little while back, he elects not to pit, so he's going to keep it out there.
He did hit that wall quite hard.
Yeah, and he's going to keep it out there. He's struggling, though. I don't know. I would have elected to just bring it on into the pits, given the fact that this is like a four-minute lap. So he's going to try to make it work out there for another lap.
I mean, okay, we'll keep an eye on his time as he, you know, as he goes round.
Yeah.
Bear in mind that Peter and Lucas Dittrich is behind him. We're watching him now go through the Donald chicane. Not fast, I'm going to say. Looks like he is kind of damage imitation almost, it seems.
Whoa. We just had two or three cars have just left the game.
Yep. Looks like
four or five cars
at the 1 hour mark here.
So, some sort of technical error there. That's a lot of cars, and that's out. And who's that out? It's Jay Eklund. Daniel Pizzo, our leader.
Pizzo, Eklund, Komisarczyk, and Dittrich.
And it looks like this is... I'm not quite sure what we're going to go on with this, guys.
Yeah, we might have to get it resorted here.
Big DNF. What may happen is the race may be red flagged and then they're allowed to join back in again. It looks like it was server error, but not a
it didn't
individual
affect
thing.
Everyone, right?
This Motorset's car has just disappeared as well.
Okay. Well, we'll keep you updated, guys, as soon as we know what's happening.
Okay, something happened. If there anyone could come into my channel and explain, please.
Do you want to go and do...
Hang on.
Yeah, right. So...
I'll find the channel.
Stephen Bailey going down to tell Jimmy Anderson what's what. Unfortunately, it looks like there was some sort of error. We get that a lot in our factor, unfortunately, and it's something that they worked to fix. But in this case, a lot of drivers, you know, suffering with that, and even Jimmy, who's driving, noticed something went wrong.
Okay, guys, red flag. We have a lot of disconnects. Red flag.
So red flag, first time in the race, 1 hour.
So
in.
There it is. Yep.
Red flag out, and that means I get to use my little red flag picture that Timo's prepared for us very nicely.
We didn't have to use it, but that's a shame.
It happens sometimes.
Yeah, we are prepared for these types of things. We did just get word from Jimmy Allison, one of the stewards there, and we'll get it all sorted out.
That's right. While this is happening, we can take some questions about, obviously, the racing or the sim. I think someone's asking.
Yeah, Blue Phoenix has got a little question here.
Red flag, guys. We will... pick up racing again in 10 minutes. In 10 minutes, I just need to figure out what happened and reset the server. So, 10 minutes, and we'll be racing again.
There you go. That's Jimmy Allison, our Lord and Savior, telling us what is what. But yeah, saying is this similar to iRacing, where everyone is a person, no AI? No, you can race with AI in Laugh Factor 2 if you choose to do so. But these are real people right now. These are real people. That's a very good sentence. I've been doing very well. Only an hour in, and that's happening already. What's going on, ladies and gents? What is going on? I think this will be a very good point for us to very quickly restart the stream.
Very good idea. Yep. And get that first part of the race uploaded right on over to the Grip TV Live YouTube account. So be looking out for this first hour of the live race in action, the start of the 24-hour Le Mans. It was a pretty good hour, man. We saw a lot of action, didn't we?
We did, and hopefully when we get back running again, we'll get a similar action. So bear with us, guys. It's very quickly going to restart.